Live from Lucky Inc. Herzlich willkommen zu einer weiteren Folge von Nahtlos, das Lifestyle-Podcast. Heute mit einem echten Weltstar vor unserem kleinen Podcast-Mikrofon. Und dazu vielleicht ganz kurz die Vorgeschichte dieses Gesprächs. Eigentlich sind wir ja kein Celebrity-Podcast und wir suchen ja eher nach den Lifestyle-Persönlichkeiten, die noch nicht jedem Medien alles erzählt haben. Und deshalb haben wir auch kurz gezögert, als uns ein Interview mit Popbarde James Blunt angeboten wurde. Anlass seines Besuchs hier bei uns in München war die Vorstellung eines Max Parfums, also ein neuer Duft von der Modemarke Max, für den er als Werbegesicht von Plakaten lächelt. Doch habe ich mich gefragt, was redet man mit einem Popstar, der ja ein Image hat als Frauenversteher, als Saubermann und dem Männer gern unterstellen, er würde irgendwie so weinerlich klingen beim Singen, dachte ich zunächst. Doch wenn man dann ein paar Google-Seiten tiefer in die Recherche einsteigt, dann findet man zumindest einen Biografiefakt, der doch zu Fragen anregt. Denn James Blunt, der 1974 in Wiltshire als James Hillier Blount, damals war noch ein O in seinem Nachnamen, geboren wurde, kommt aus einer Familie mit sehr langer Militärtradition. Und auch er selbst wurde Offizier der Life Guards in der britischen Armee und war mit seinem Regiment dann im Rahmen des KFOR-Einsatzes im Kosovo stationiert. Und zu seinen Aufgaben und zu seiner Militärvita gehört ebenso die Einnahme des Flughafens von Pristina, wie auch eine Rolle als Sargträger bei der Beerdigung von Queen Mum im Jahr 2002. Noch im Kosovo schrieb er dann das Lied No Bravery, das seine Musikkarriere starten sollte. Entdeckt hat ihn dann später Linda Perry, die Sängerin der Four Non Blondes, 90er Jahre Kinder werden sich sicherlich an die wilde Dreadlock-Frau mit der rauen Stimme erinnern, die dann später auf Produzentin und Songwriterin umsattelte. Und als ich das alles gelesen hatte, habe ich gedacht, okay, neben den klaren Fragen zum aktuellen Projekt mit Max finden wir schon Gesprächsstoff. Und also haben wir dann ein kurzes Interview mit James Blunt führen können und in dem Gespräch, was ihr gleich hört, geht es um seine Erfahrung im Krieg, um den Duft des Erfolges und auch die, sein eigenes Duftgedächtnis, denn fast jeder Mensch verbindet Situationen, Orte und Menschen mit Gerüchen. Außerdem sprechen wir über seine Wahlheimat Ibiza, wo er den größten Teil des Jahres lebt. Und wir sprechen auch über das dicke Fell, das man sich als Künstler wachsen lassen muss, um gegenüber, gerade in Zeiten des Internet, um gegenüber Gerüchten ein bisschen gewappnet zu sein. Kurz vor unserem Interview ging zum Beispiel in der britischen Presse das Gerücht um, James Blunt wolle sich zur Ruhe setzen. Ein kurzer Talk, dessen Zwischentöne, ich hoffe, das hört man auch in der Audioversion raus, darauf deuten, dass unter der glatten Oberfläche dieses wirklich grundsympathischen und sehr bescheiden auftretenden Popstars eine melancholische Nachdenklichkeit schlummert, die er, so denke ich, wohl nur in seiner Musik so richtig nach außen kanalisieren kann. Und natürlich steigen wir mit einem kurzen Clip seines Welthits You're Beautiful in dieses Interview ein, bei dem wir euch ganz viel Vergnügen wünschen. Hier nun also anlässlich der Duftpremiere von Max ein Interview mit James Blunt. Als kurzes PS noch kurz der Hinweis, dass ihr natürlich auch das Transkript unseres Interviews mit James Blunt auf nahtlosblog.de/podcast findet und in den Shownotes dort haben wir auch die Videos gepostet zum Werbespot von Max, das Making-of und den fertigen Clip. Also auch unbedingt einen Blick wert, denn am Anfang des Interviews geht es unter anderem um die
you're German, because you've lived in Soest for like 10 years. That's no. What I read. Is that not true?
32 years.
Oh, 2 years.
But I was when I was 10 years old.
Right.
That's
so. It's all gone now. The German.
And it was only in the holidays because my parents lived there.
Right.
I was at school in England. In the holidays, I lived in Germany. It was as a child, it was the most amazing experience because you know I was living. Soest has the Monasee.
Right.
And our garden ran into the water. And on three sides of the house, the garden went into
like
the
an island.
Oh yeah, it was an absolutely amazing place. So as a child, it was the best place in the world.
That was because your father was stationed in Germany.
Yeah, exactly.
Because of the military history of your family.
Exactly.
I read somewhere that he. I don't know if it's true or not. That's why I'm asking you. But that he like never forgave you that you did not follow into your his and then probably even your grandfather's footsteps and
no, that's definitely started. Rubbish. Definitely rubbish.
Okay. So set the record straight then.
Yeah.
did he love it that you went into music?
Well, I did follow his footsteps. I did join the army.
Right.
And I did 6 years in that. You know, it was a job. He didn't. He never forced me. He never. You know, he just introduced me to the army. He never forced me to join the army. And then when I said I was leaving, he gave me very good fatherly advice, saying the music business is a very difficult business to be successful in. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know, absolutely, I understand on a commercial level, but I want success for me is about happiness. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I went into, and you know, I was chasing a dream, and it's important to live life and not waste it.
Mm-hmm. And what sort of advice would you give your younger self now that you've accomplished so much and established yourself as a pop singer with amazing record sales and loyal fan base worldwide? What would you say to the younger James Blunt who had the dream?
Absolutely, I would say don't do interviews with journalists in the UK.
Why is that?
But outside the UK, carry on as normal. That would be the only thing that I ever say. That's best advice.
And what's the thing that you learned maybe about yourself on pursuing that dream?
Well, I've learned really kind of simple things. I left home when I was 7 years old to go to a boarding school. I went to university and I joined the army for 6 years.
Wow.
I really left my family, as I say, from about 7 years old and didn't really see them very much.
So but you now, had the independence and self-reliance already, yeah.
But what I've seen as I've travelled and as I've come into this business, which is so shallow in so many ways, is that the people who really count, you know, for all our aspirations of fame and fortune, the people who really count are friends and family. Mm-hmm. And now, having done music, I'm now much closer to my family, much closer to my friends than I ever was, as I'm reliant on them to keep things simple and down to earth and grounded, which I assume is why the Mechs have kind of approached me in the first place, because it reflects what they are putting across with Mechs Pure. It's that kind of vein.
And you succeeded in leading this squeaky clean showbiz life. I mean, that's an accomplishment in and of itself, right?
You know, I don't think I live a squeaky clean way of life through it at all. I've never claimed to either. What I am...
But that's a perception, the media perception.
No, I don't think it is. I mean, people know that I live in Ibiza, that I am I'm nocturnal. but what I think, what I hope that I am clear about is that, you know, my performances aren't about feathers and fur and outfits and all these things.
And you're dancing crazy.
My dance moves are enthusiastic. But, you know, but I stand up on stage and I'm open and I'm honest. I am myself, again, authentic in the way that I try and express myself. Mm-hmm. It's honest, which, again, is what we're talking about with Mechs Pure.
Mm-hmm. One more question, then we could certainly come to the fragrance itself. Ibiza, what role does this magical place play in your life, other than it is your home in a way? Is it a retreat? What makes it so special to you?
It's special in the same way that anyone's home is special. It is just simply that to me. Mm-hmm. It's a home.
But why there, not Britain, where you grew up?
Well, I tour most of the time. For the last 7 years, I've been on tour full time for 5 years. Most of the time in the summers, I've had about 2 weeks holiday, 2 weeks break. And if you have 2 weeks in your life for 5 years, someone said, hey, do you want to go back and to your home in grey, rainy London? Or do you want to go back to your home in sunny, Mediterranean-based, Spanish-cultured Ibiza? You'd be mad if you chose the former.
Now, coming to scents, is there a special scent? Because every human being connects certain people, moments, situations with a smell. Can you recall a scent from your childhood? Just one, like randomly?
Yeah, very much. You know, and I think it's probably the first. You know, as a child, as a baby, your experience of life. You know, you don't even have very good vision or hearing, but smell will be really strong in that. And so the smell of parents, their mm-hmm. identity, is very much wrapped up in smell, isn't it? Mm-hmm. I'm sure all of us can identify.
Sure, but is there a certain scent, like grandma's porridge or whatever?
No, as I say, the smell of family, of loved mm-hmm. ones, that's the strongest smell there, strongest identity mm-hmm. that I can think of.
Mm-hmm. And, of course, you've been stationed in Kosovo. Is there also a certain scent that you remember from being there, or a scent of the military as you've experienced it yourself?
Absolutely more than you can possibly fathom. Mm-hmm. It's one of the strongest memories I have from that time, and mm-hmm. a terrible one.
Okay. I don't want to be a downer in this conversation. Coming to music, is there a connection between your sense of smell and your musical talent? I mean, do melodies, or is that a totally crazy question? Do melodies connect in your senses with a sense of smell?
I think probably not. No, I think if I'm stepping on stage, if I hadn't showered for, you know, 5 days, and I sensed that I was going to be looked at by lots of people, where you hope that they, you know, and you sense that you were feeling unclean, even in your smell, even though they're a distance, I think your self-confidence would go down.
Okay.
Because you could sense that. And as such, that's why I'm a very clean person.
So that's an important
The practicality of being on tour, for maintaining oneself, in the same way that it is in the army, to, mm-hmm. you know, you maintain your weapon and you maintain yourself as a human being. Mm-hmm. You do that on stage, and I think it's important to be clean. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Mm-hmm. So to a degree... Uh-huh. Yes, but just for the sake of the performance. And
now, of course, Max, they produced the commercial, the videos with you and a beautiful model. You've been in front of a camera for your music videos, of course, before. So in a way, it's nothing new. But what was different, and what was a funny or crazy anecdote from the shoot itself?
Well, I suppose what was different is it wasn't the same vein as it wasn't, a music video. It was for something that wasn't associated directly with, you know, my music. Instead, it was someone else's idea. And in many ways, I found it much easier, much more fun.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because I'm not naturally a model. Mm-hmm. I am too short and too average looking to be one, not normally. So what makes the thinking? I don't know. But the way they structured it was just much more at ease than the music videos that I've done. As I say, I'm uncomfortable in front of a camera normally. A microphone is my mm-hmm. weapon of choice. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
But it was rather exotic, right? It was in Africa?
No, it was in Paris.
Oh, you were in Paris. Okay.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And it was an amazing, kind of loft-type house, apartment. Really stunning. But yeah, of the anecdotes, you know, there were no weird and wonderful things. It was just really much more relaxed and much more fun than normal videos I've experienced. Then again, the videos I've normally had, they've thrown me off a cliff, haven't they, or set me on fire, or buried me in the sand. So, you know, not hard.
Two more questions. You're involved in, and have been for years, in different charities. If you could give a shout out for one of the causes that are very dear to your heart,
yeah, absolutely.
To our listeners, please do now.
Médecins Sans Frontières is the one I cherish the most. In English, that's Doctors Without Borders. Mm-hmm. They give medical care and attention to the people who suffer in natural disasters and in war. And those people, far more than soldiers actually, are the civilians who get caught up in war.
Mm-hmm. And what sort of support, other than probably money, do you provide for
it's as simple as that. I'm not It's something I talk about a lot. I'm not a doctor, and I don't save a life. Sure. And so my role is relegated simply to raising awareness for them and raising finances for them. But it's that role is easy and a pleasure because they're an absolutely mind-blowing organization who do a phenomenal job.
Mm-hmm. Final question. A couple of years after you had your breakthrough, of course there's always talk and there's gossip and stuff. And some people said that you went from being a soldier, as you said, you were in the army for 6 years, to being a softie. Is that, first of all, on some level a fair assessment? And secondly, what did you prefer?
I think public perception is public perception. Would I worry about that? No. Have I changed as a person? When I took the uniform off, did I become someone else? No, I didn't. I look much bigger with a gun.
That's a great last word, James Bond. Thank you very much for taking the time.
Thank you for listening to our show. Please remember to rate this podcast on iTunes and spread the word. Oh, and we're on Facebook too. Drop us a line. We'll be back next week.